There were cities all over America that were safe havens for gangsters. Hot Springs, Arkansas, Cicero, Illinois, outside of Chicago. But more than any of those other safe cities was St. Paul. It was estimated that 50% of Minnesotans were involved in making bootleg liquor in those days. The other 50% were buying it from them. This Minnesota area was also well situated to make bootleg liquor, to break the prohibition law. We had a lot of Germans, and Germans know how to make beer. We had more breweries per capita than almost any city in America. When you break the law and make illegal liquor, you need water. You need fresh water. We had the Mississippi River, only a few yards from where we're standing today. And we're very close to the border of Canada. So liquor could be imported and exported over the Canadian border. So as a result, this area was a haven for bootlegging and became a haven for public enemies and gangsters. In the 1930s, virtually every major gangster, kidnapper, and bank robber in America lived and worked within a 3-block radius of where we're standing today. John Dillinger, Babyface Nelson, Alvin Creepy Carpus, all were here. People don't know that. There's no statues of these gangsters, but this was the epicenter of 1930s crime in the era of John Dillinger. Basically, the police in St. Paul at the turn of the century sent the word out to gangsters, bank robbers, kidnappers, come to St. Paul. You can be here. You have to promise not to kill or rob anyone within the city limits of St. Paul, and of course pay a bribe. As long as you're on your good behavior, Mr. John Dillinger, Babyface Nelson, Creepy Carpus, you are welcome in our city. So the deal between the crooks and the gangsters was tolerated for almost 3 decades. And the people of St. Paul would see the most notorious gangsters in America, wanted men like bank robber John Dillinger, walking along the street, and it was like seeing a celebrity. But you wouldn't fear for your life in St. Paul in the 1930s because you knew the fix was in. The crooks were on their best behavior. It's March 1934, and the most wanted man in America, public enemy number one, bank robber John Dillinger, is living right behind us in apartment 303 of St. Paul's Lincoln Court Apartments to basically regroup, to get his bank robbery gang ready for a crime spree. So he was here enjoying time with his girlfriend. They went to the movies just 1 block away from us. But meanwhile, his gang is getting weapons, getaway cars, and casing which banks they'll rob from their home base here in St. Paul. Now, the FBI didn't know that this was John Dillinger, but they began to get hints that a strange man was living in this apartment building. The shades were always drawn to the bottom. Dillinger never came out to get his mail, but the big tip-off was John Dillinger's girlfriend, a beautiful Menominee Indian woman from Wisconsin named Billy Frechette, would come out on this grass and hang up John Dillinger's laundry dressed in a halter top and short shorts. I've talked to men in their 80s who remember 70 years ago when Dillinger was here, and they said, oh my God, this girl was so beautiful. They still remember Dillinger's girlfriend. So the FBI sent a crew here to knock on Dillinger's door, but they didn't know. They thought it was Carl Hellman, which was John Dillinger's alias when he lived above at 303. You're walking toward John Dillinger's apartment. It's apartment 303. All you know is that there's something suspicious in apartment 303. You knock, this is Dillinger's door right here, and Dillinger is in bed with his girlfriend, Billy Frechette. She opens the door, peeks out, and you, the FBI, go, ma'am, we're here to speak to Carl Hellman. The dear woman forgets her own alias. She goes, Carl, Carl, oh, my husband. And the FBI are not fools. They go, ma'am, we're staying right here. You go and get Carl. She runs to the bed, says, John, John, the jig is up. It's the FBI.
Dillinger, cool as a cucumber, says, "Dear, get your clothes on." He pulls on his pants, gets a machine gun, comes to this door, opens it slightly, leans out, grins at the FBI, and starts firing machine gun bullets out of this door. The police and the FBI start firing back at him. This door is chewed up by bullets. To give you a sense, John Dillinger, not a master criminal, not a single bullet from Dillinger's gun hits any of the FBI agents in the actual corridor that you're in right now, but one bullet from the FBI and the police's gun hits John Dillinger in the thigh.
Incredibly, John Dillinger has escaped from the FBI shootout. He lays down fire and comes out this door. Now, Dillinger is wounded in the leg, so Dillinger races over here, stands here holding a submachine gun in one hand and a gun in the other, and tells his girlfriend, Billy Frechette, get the getaway car. So literally the most wanted man in America is standing here, bleeding like a stuck pig. A boy, Louis Schroth, in this building next door, sees the man who he recognizes as John Dillinger, bank robber, reaches under his bed, takes out a shotgun and aims it at Dillinger, who is here. The kid is seconds from becoming the boy who killed John Dillinger when his Louis's mother, hearing the shots that were from here, tackles her son, throws him to the ground, and Dillinger is not killed in St. Paul. He gets in the getaway car with his girl and he roars away to Wisconsin, Rhinelander, Wisconsin, for a little rest and relaxation at the Little Bohemia Lodge. The deal between the crooks and the cops, which had stood for years, meaning the crooks live here but they don't kill or kidnap anyone here, fell apart. The history of the building that we're in right now, which is today called Landmark Center, but in the 1930s, the Public Enemies era, it was called the Old Federal Courts Building. The history here is incredible. Above our heads on the fifth floor is the offices of the Prohibition Bureau. And the man who headed the Prohibition Bureau was the man who wrote the American Prohibition Law, the Volstead Act. It was Andrew Volstead, a congressman from Granite Falls, Minnesota, who created Prohibition in this building. Then when the Prohibition was repealed, and all of these bootleggers, what were they going to do? Liquor was legal. They turned to bank robbery, kidnapping, labor racketeering, extortion, and murder. And that's what this building became then. The FBI, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, with J. Edgar Hoover, had this building as their headquarters. And as they say, if these walls could talk, what notorious stories they could tell. In the mid-1930s, bank robber John Dillinger's girlfriend, Evelyn, nicknamed Billy Frechette, was tried successfully in this room. But before she was found guilty of harboring her boyfriend, John Dillinger, she tried to escape. She said she had to go to the ladies' room. The federal marshals with her followed her through this door. And then the men, the marshals, somewhat shy, stood back, allowing Billy Frechette, Dillinger's girlfriend, to go toward the bathroom, at which point she simply kept on going down this hallway and tried to escape. Fortunately, the federal marshals overcame their shyness about a female soon-to-be convict and grabbed her and made sure that she did not escape en route to the powder room. The FBI was quite concerned that the Dillinger gang would try to come here with their machine guns and free Dillinger's girlfriend. So in the kind of the porches that you see behind my head, there were federal marshals armed with sawed-off shotguns and Thompson submachine guns waiting in case any members of the Barker Karpus gang or the Dillinger gang would show up to liberate their comrades. It never happened. But you can imagine what it was like in this room in the sweltering heat of the summers of 35 and 36 when all the gangsters were here and everybody was waiting to see if other gangsters with machine guns would come and try to free them. We're here in the basement of Landmark Center, which is open to the public if you come to St. Paul. Right here is the radiator that the director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, kept one of the public enemies, Alvin Creepy Karpus, handcuffed to just before Hoover dragged Karpis into the courtroom to have him convicted. He pled guilty to the Ham kidnapping of the 1930s. This is a photo of Alvin Creepy Karpis, a fascinating character, had something of a heart. He promised that if any kids were around, he would make sure that the kids weren't killed if he did a shootout with the FBI. Karpis pled guilty to the 1933 kidnapping of millionaire William Ham, spent decades in prison. When he got out, all of the ill-gotten loot, his kidnap money, ransom, his bank robbery loot, was in banks, accruing full interest while Karpis was in prison. Karpis gets out of prison, an old man. He's a wealthy man, goes to Torremolina, Spain, where he is seen eating fine food, cavorting with 19-year-old girlfriends. And then one night, Karpis takes an overdose of sleeping pills and wine and takes his own life. Didn't leave a note. I think he just knew that his time had come, and he had enjoyed the good life as a gangster. He was an old man, and he decided to end his life. In this building is both the inception of prohibition that led to widespread organized crime all over America. That's how Al Capone got his start as a bootlegger. And then in 1934, 35, 36, this is also the building where all of those bootleggers and bank robbers were tried and sent to Alcatraz, Leavenworth Prison, and other prisons across America. It's where it began and where it ended. So every gangster in America came here. And as a result, St. Paul in the 1930s, I wouldn't call it Las Vegas, but it was a very lively city because the gangsters brought their gun mules. During Prohibition, you had the biggest jazz artists of the decades here in St. Paul. So it was a very, very lively place, partially because the gangsters were welcome here. We are only a few yards away from the Mississippi River in downtown St. Paul, but we are in the underground gangster caves. This is today called the Wabasha Caves, but back in the 1920s and 1930s, it was called the Castle Royale. It was run as a gambling casino by gangsters. And the underground caves have a fascinating history. These caves were naturally made in soft limestone by water dripping from the Mississippi River. When Prohibition was passed, the bootleggers realized it's dark, it's cold, it's private. Let's fill this room with illegal beer. Then Prohibition was repealed. And the bootleggers who filled this cave with illegal beer said, okay, beer is legal, let's do nightclubs. So the gangsters of St. Paul and the good people of St. Paul who liked partying with gangsters came here. This club, this was a nightclub, as well as other caves nearby, were filled with tuxedoed waiters, chandeliers, kitchens. But mind you, it was also where John Dillinger, the Barker Karpis gang, and other notorious gangsters also liked to hang out. I think the appeal of this underground nightclub was that you were rubbing elbows with the most wanted bank robbers in America. Today, we look at the mafia with horror, organized crime, as terrible people, which they are. But in those days, the bank robbers, like John Dillinger, were seen almost like Robin Hoods. They were seen as post-depression, when the banks would foreclose on your farm. The bank would foreclose on your house. The banks weren't really popular, and the bank robbers were just robbing the bankers. So for a lot of people in those days, bank robbers were seen as kind of anti-heroes who were evening the score after the Depression, which is totally untrue. They were killers who wanted money, but the public saw the gangsters in a more romantic light. And you knew as you drank with them that they wouldn't kill you because St. Paul had the deal between the cops and the crooks. There was a very rigid process. If you were a bank robber or a kidnapper coming into St. Paul, Minnesota by train, let's say, from Chicago, there were rules. The rules were you would identify yourself when you got off the train. Hello, my name is Al Capone. You would give a bribe to the police. Here's some jewelry that we stole in Chicago. Here you go. If you needed a place to stay, the police would arrange for housing for you as a bank robber. If you needed a gun, the best submachine guns in America were available to you here in St. Paul. If you needed a getaway car, there were auto dealers in St. Paul who specialized in bank robbery getaway cars, heavily armored on both sides to deflect police bullets. And if you needed a girl, female companionship, the police would arrange for a girlfriend. In fact, Alvin Creepy Carpus, the gangster, met the love of his life, Dolores Delaney, here in St. Paul. Essentially, St. Paul was a department store for gangsters. If you needed a girl, a gun, to launder money, you needed a getaway car, you came to St. Paul, and the police made sure you, as a gangster, got whatever you needed. The FBI were trustworthy, and they were not corrupt. And it drove the FBI crazy that the police in St. Paul, Minnesota, were in the pockets of the gangsters who would be partying here. When Ma Barker was living on South Robert Street in St. Paul, only a few miles from where we're standing today, the FBI got a tip that Ma Barker and her bad boys, the Barker gang, were there. The FBI raced to the house, and by the time they got there, the Barker gang was gone, tipped off by the St. Paul police. So there was no love lost between the FBI of J. Edgar Hoover and the corrupt local constabulary of the police who were taking bribes, who were on the take from the underworld that partied here. They wanted to, in a way, live the high life and leave a good-looking corpse. And that's what happened. They ate well, they slept with beautiful women, they drank wonderful wine, and I think these gangsters knew that their lives were short, and they lived that gangster life in St. Paul.